Well, hello everyone. This is Dr. Ashwini Kumar, and today I'm here with you to discuss the cadaveric image-based questions which were asked in the recent AIIMS exam. Basically, we're not going to discuss the questions here. We're going to discuss the images of the upper limb. We usually, when we discuss all these images in the classes or in the apps or wherever, we usually discuss it on the schematic line diagrams, which is a good way to go about it. But looking at the recent AIIMS pattern, it looks like that they are now switching more toward the questions which are based on the images in the cadaver itself. Recently, NEET also, when they asked a question on one of the forearm muscle, that was also a cadaveric image. So I guess this is one change we need to do, that we have to switch not only toward the schematic line diagrams, but we also have to understand and try to identify those structures on the cadaveric images here. So today in this session, today I'm going to talk about the images of the upper limb. I'm going to start with the muscles of the shoulder region. We'll talk about the section of the axilla. We'll talk about the brachial plexus, how to identify the branches of the brachial plexus. And then eventually we will talk about the muscles of the forearm, back of the forearm, front of the forearm, hand muscles, and especially the blood vessels and nerves and how to differentiate between them here. So it will be a good quick revision for you all. Let me start with the first image that you see in front of you. Guys, this is a picture showing the deltoid muscle. As you can see, this muscle here is the deltoid. Anterior fiber of the deltoid can be seen, and the muscle that you see here is the pectoralis major. Don't bother too much about the labeling thing, because I'm providing with a soft copy of all the labeled images. So that's a pectoralis major muscle. Recently, this question is about the pectoralis major is also asked, that what type of fibers do we have in pectoralis major. So it is a spiral type of muscle. It's having a broad origin, but when you look at the insertion of the muscle, it is very narrow. How can we have a narrow insertion with still having a broad origin? That is because the inserting fiber of the pectoralis major, they actually turns backward and they insert to the lateral lip of the bicipital groove. Now guys, the space that you see between the anterior fiber of deltoid and pectoralis major, this is called as the deltopectoral groove. That groove over there is called as deltopectoral groove, and this deltopectoral groove is having two major content. One, you can already see there very clearly, that is a cephalic vein. The one main content here is a cephalic vein, and the other content here is the deltoid branch. Look at this branch which I'm pointing at. That is the deltoid branch of thoracoacromial artery. As I said, just don't bother too much about the labeling. Anyways, we'll be discussing separately. So we have a deltoid muscle, the pectoralis major muscle, and the groove in between is a deltopectoral groove, having two main content. One is a cephalic vein, the vein on the lateral side of the upper limb, and the artery that you see is a deltoid branch of thoracoacromial artery. So that's first image to start with. Okay, this pectoralis major muscle, behind the pectoralis major muscle, we have pectoralis minor muscle. And this pectoralis major and minor, they both are actually forming the anterior axillary fold. Again, a recent question only, just a year back, there was a question asked in the AIIMS in which they gave a transverse section of the axilla and you have to identify the structures in that. So looking at this picture, now you know that what anterior axillary fold is. Anterior axillary fold is by the pectoralis major muscle and also the minor. So if I take a transverse section of axilla, let's see how it's going to look like. So here is the image which is showing the transverse section of the axilla. The first challenge here is to identify whether it is, what side is this, what is anterior, posterior, median, and lateral in this. It's very simple, guys. You can clearly find out the humerus bone in this. Now that this is a humerus, right? And now if this is a humerus, so obviously this is the lateral side of this image. This becomes the medial side. This curve is because of the rib only, rib cage only, so there is a medial side. Now we need to see what is anterior and posterior. When it comes to anterior and posterior axillary fold, see, anterior axillary fold is made up of pectoralis major and minor, the two muscles. But when you look at posterior axillary fold, we do have the muscles in front of the scapula and behind the scapula also. So this posterior axillary fold, or the muscle which are assisting, or they're like present along with the posterior axillary fold, will make it more thicker. Look at this thin layer here and look at this huge layer on that side. The thin layer here is made up of two muscles. This muscle is pectoralis major And the muscle that you see behind it, its pectoralis minor muscle. The two muscles which are forming the anterior axillary fold. Whereas posterior axillary fold, for that, I wanted to just focus on this very thin sheet that you can see. This is actually a blade of the scapula only. And in front of the scapula, the one big muscle which is present in front of the scapula is subscapularis muscle. So this here is the subscapularis muscle, which you can see in this section. Behind subscapularis, that means behind the scapula, well, this section is obviously below the spine of the scapula, because otherwise the section would have been very high. We are looking at the axillary wall, so I presume that that section is taken below the level of the spine of the scapula. So the muscle that you see behind the scapula and below the spine is infraspinatus. That's an infraspinatus muscle to be seen here. So lateral axillary fold, you can see a lateral part of the axilla, we have a humerus there. Medial axillary fold is by the rib cage, and we all know that the muscle which is attached on the outer surface of the rib cage, attached to the first eight rib, is the serratus anterior muscle. So medially you can see it's serratus anterior, laterally we have the humerus, anteriorly anterior axillary fold is by the two muscle, that is pectoralis major and minor, which is again defining it that this is going to be the anterior wall, and subscapularis, infraspinatus is not forming the axillary wall. The muscle which is present on the anterior surface of scapula are doing so. So subscapularis one is the one which is present posteriorly. So broadly, these are the boundaries of the axilla in a cadaveric image. That's how you can identify. I would say the biggest hint here, go with the bone first, where is the humerus, and then go with the size of the axillary fold. Anterior axillary fold is much, much thinner when you compare with the posterior axillary fold, because the muscles on the scapula are on both the surface. Well, obviously, in between that here, this space here is the axilla. We cannot appreciate the contents very well in this. Although we have, if I just kind of enlarge and zoom in, I could see some nerves running around here. These are the cords of brachial plexus, not to be seen very clearly. But as of now, in this section, I can mark these are the axillary vessels. We have axillary vessels and cords of brachial plexus. Axillary vessels and cords of brachial plexus. So that's the transverse section of the axilla, and these are some inputs that you need to know, that how to identify the anterior, posterior and median lateral net. Okay, now moving on to this one very important thing, that were the major content of the axilla, that is the brachial plexus. Let's do it in two parts, guys. First, let's identify the brachial plexus, the beginning part, where are the roots, what muscles are forming, giving the passage to the brachial plexus, how the trunk is formed, another recent question of Ames. And then we will look at the cord, and there are at least major branches of the cord of brachial plexus should be identified. Not every all upper and lower subscapular, no, but the major branches, you should be able to identify them. So here we go, guys. This is a picture that you're looking at. It is again a cadaveric image. The only thing we did is that we only highlighted the brachial plexus part here, and the rest we left it like in the black and white mode, so that we can clearly appreciate these nerves in there. Okay, let's start it from the beginning only. Now, if this is the portion that you can see the brachial plexus emerging out, we all know that brachial plexus comes out between the two muscle. One is the scalenus anterior and the scalenus medius muscle. So look at this muscle here. I'll be writing everything in short only. This is scalenus anterior, and this muscle is the scalenus medius muscle. And you can see how brachial plexus, roots of brachial plexus are emerging out between the anterior and the medius. Even before we go to the brachial plexus, can you see this nerve running in front of the scalenus anterior? One very important relation in the neck also, that nerve runs in front of the scalenus anterior, but behind prevertebral fascia, that's the phrenic nerve. So it's the phrenic nerve that you can see running in front of the scalenus anterior here. Formation of brachial plexus, as we know, is from C5 to T1, right? So what you can see, this is C5 and C6 root, right? Look at this, the one I'm pointing at, the C5 and C6. I'm just enlarging it a bit more here. That is a C7, and here is C8 and T1. As you can see, C5 and C6, they are uniting, and they're giving rise to this upper trunk of the brachial plexus. If I just again mark in short only, there is an upper trunk of brachial plexus. This one here is a middle trunk of brachial plexus. which is made up of only C7, and here is the lower trunk of the brachial plexus, which is made up of C7, C8 and T1. After the trunk part, then comes the division of the brachial plexus, the division where the root values substantially will change and will get assisted by the other part as well. And then eventually we have the formation of cords of brachial plexus. Now that's the challenging part, the cords of the brachial plexus. But as I said, before we go to the cord part, is there any nerve which is coming out of the root? The nerve which we can easily identify here is the nerve that you see coming out from C5, C6 and C7, although I cannot see their origin well, but I can see that nerve running along the lateral side of the rib cage and supplying serratus anterior. That is the long thoracic nerve. It's a long thoracic nerve that you're looking at, and that is the one which is supplying the serratus anterior muscle coming from the C5, C6 and C8 root, C5, C6 and C7. Let's understand the cords of brachial plexus. Now we have the three cords of brachial plexus. We got a lateral cord, medial cord and posterior cord. And the nomenclature of the cord is purely based on the relation with the axillary artery. What is the relation of the cords of brachial plexus? The axillary artery. If it is like axillary artery will be somewhere in the middle, not drawing it here, not shown here. So that is the lateral cord of brachial plexus. This is a medial cord of brachial plexus. And look at that one there behind. That is a posterior cord of brachial plexus. Let me highlight these nerves for you. This is the lateral cord of brachial plexus. And you can see some nerves coming out of it, like this one and this one, all these nerves that you see coming out in there, right? Even this is contribution from the lateral. This here is the medial cord of brachial plexus. Look at that. That's a medial cord of brachial plexus also contributing to this one. And then you can see one major nerve running along with this. This is coming from the medial cord. And the one which is hidden behind here, that is the posterior cord of brachial plexus. Look at that one. This is a posterior cord and that's the major continuation from the posterior cord. You can see this another nerve here coming from the posterior cord itself. Okay, let's try to identify these nerves. Here we go. Guys, first of all, by the contribution by the lateral cord and medial cord, that's a lateral root and that is a medial root. This nerve is formed here and this major nerve is a median nerve. So when you're looking at a brachial plexus and you have to identify the median nerve, always look at the origin. It is formed by the lateral root of median nerve coming from lateral cord and medial root of medial nerve, which is all coming from the medial cord of brachial plexus. Lateral cord of brachial plexus have three branches. We call them LML branches. LML. One L is this only, that is a lateral root of median nerve, which is already contributing here. Another L is lateral pectoral nerve, which is supplying the pectoralis minor muscle and major muscle here. That is lateral pectoral nerve piercing the clavipectoral fascia also. And then we have this another important nerve that you should be able to identify here is the musculocutaneous nerve. So we said LML, lateral root of median nerve. One is lateral pectoral nerve and this is musculocutaneous nerve. Now how can I identify it as a musculocutaneous nerve? We know that musculocutaneous nerve is the major nerve supplying the muscles in the anterior compartment of the arm. How it enters into the arm? It enters into the arm by piercing the coracobrachialis muscle and then running between the biceps and brachialis. Look at this nerve here. This nerve is piercing this muscle and this is the coracobrachialis muscle. That's a coracobrachialis muscle. The nerve is piercing it and then it will enter into the anterior compartment of arm running between the biceps and brachialis. Do not confuse this nerve with this one here, the one which is close by only, but you can see that nerve is not piercing this muscle, that is going through some space over there, which is a quadrangular space. We'll come to that. When you look at the posterior cord of brachial plexus, like numerous branches on the posterior cord, the major branches being like upper subscapular nerve, lower subscapular nerve. I'm sure you all heard of this mnemonic, lunar or ulnar, if I say ulnar. It's a mnemonic for the posterior cord of brachial plexus. So we have a nerve called as upper subscapular and lower subscapular. Again, I strongly believe that these are not the kind of nerve to be asked in the exam because it becomes a bit complicated when the blood vessels and everything is there. But just for the sake of identification in here, that nerve over there is a subscapular nerve. Guys, look at the muscle first. Look, this huge muscle here is subscapularis. That muscle which is forming the posterior axillary fold is a subscapularis muscle. And that nerve over there is the upper subscapular nerve, if I may mark it here. That is the upper subscapular nerve. And look at this nerve here, which is called as lower subscapular nerve. Lower subscapular nerve, and it's also a question asked in the NEET exam. Lower subscapular nerve is supplying subscapularis, as you can see, and it is also supplying this teres major muscle. Look at this muscle here, that is teres major. That's how these three muscles are in the line forming the posterior wall of the axilla. Subscapularis, that is subscapularis, if I just may write S here, subscapularis. The TM writing is for the teres major muscle. And below that is a latissimus dorsi. The three muscle in that sequence present here, which are forming the posterior axillary fold or the posterior wall of axilla. In the transverse section, we only appreciated subscapularis, but when you see it from this side, you can see all the three muscles. Subscapularis, teres, and latissimus dorsi. So you can see this lower subscapular nerve, this one here, is supplying not only subscapularis, but also the teres major muscle. Done with U, done with L. N. N is what? N is nerve to latissimus dorsi. Again, very clearly seen. Look at this nerve coming here down and supplying the latissimus dorsi muscle. So that is the nerve to latissimus dorsi, also called as thoracodorsal nerve. It is also referred as thoracodorsal nerve. A and R, the two most important nerve from the posterior cord, axillary nerve and radial nerve. As I told you guys, look at this. This nerve is an axillary nerve. And if you could see, it is going through the space which is called as a quadrangular space. So this is the axillary nerve which will go into the quadrangular space along with the posterior circumflex humeral vessels, which is obviously not shown here. So this nerve, which is very, very clearly and easily you can identify it in the brachial plexus picture, is the axillary nerve. And of course, this main nerve, the longest nerve of the upper limb, that is the radial nerve, which is also coming from the posterior cord. So, five branches on posterior cord, upper subscapular nerve, let me mark it again, that is the upper subscapular nerve supplying subscapularis, you can see. That's a lower subscapular nerve, not only supplying subscapularis, look at this, it is also supplying teres major. N is nerve to latissimus dorsi, look at that nerve coming down and supplying the latissimus dorsi muscle. And then we have the two main nerve, one is axillary, and then the main continuation of the posterior cord, that is a radial nerve, the major nerve supplying the extensor compartment. Finally, coming to the medial cord, the medial cord is giving off a lot of branches like medial root of median nerve that you can see here. It gives off the cutaneous nerves also, medial cutaneous nerve of arm, medial cutaneous nerve of forearm, which are not shown in this picture. The cutaneous nerves are not shown here. But the major nerve coming from medial cord is seen here, and that is the ulnar nerve. Look at that. That's the ulnar nerve here, which is coming from the medial cord of the brachial plexus. So that is about identifying the nerves, the branches coming from the root, from the trunk, and from the cords of the brachial plexus. And looking at the present scenario, I don't think that they might be asking you a question coming from the root and the trunk. That becomes a bit difficult here. The cords of the brachial plexus, especially the major branches, the radial, axillary, ulnar, median nerve, can be asked. So you should know at least these, you should have an orientation of these nerves, how to identify them in the picture. Well, what we have next up here with us is the picture showing the cubital fossa. It is a cubital fossa, it's a right cubital fossa you are looking at. Well, whenever you look at any cadaveric image, the first thing that comes to your mind is that what side is it, what view is that? Well, this is a cubital fossa, so obviously we are looking at it from the anterior aspect. But what side is that? You don't have to waste your time thinking about the median and lateral. It's very easy and it should be very quick. Look at this prominent portion here. That's a medial epicondyle, guys. We know that medial epicondyle is very prominent. So this is the prominent medial epicondyle. That's a medial side of this picture and that's the lateral side here. Obviously superior and the inferior. This muscle which they have cut here, this is the biceps brachii. That's a biceps brachii muscle supplied by the same muscular cutaneous nerve only. The reason they have cut the biceps brachii muscle apart, you can see this small part of the biceps brachii here, this is actually bicipital aponeurosis. If I continue this bicipital aponeurosis, it must be coming like this in this region and it is reinforcing the roof of the cubital fossa. So right now we are focusing on the content, that's why they have cut this, the bicipital aponeurosis. The contents of the cubital fossa, the one mnemonic that we remember, that is MBBR, when we go from medial to lateral, they say MBBR, you can say MBBS also. So from medial to lateral, that's the content of the cubital fossa. The most medial content of the cubital fossa, look at this nerve here, that is a median nerve. That's a median nerve. Followed by the median nerve is this artery here, that is the brachial artery. It's a brachial artery next. Next to the brachial artery, okay, don't bother about the one that you see along with it. These are nothing but the venae commitments only. Along with the artery, you can see another blood vessel kind of thing. That is the venae commitments. So just don't bother too much about it. More laterally we go, you will see the tendon of the biceps muscle. So it's a biceps tendon. That's a biceps tendon that you can see. And then the most lateral content, we said S, or you can say R. Well, it is a superficial branch of radial nerve. It's a superficial branch of radial nerve. I can say radial nerve is also the content, but the radial nerve actually dips inside and it goes through the two lamina of the supinator muscle in the floor of the cubital fossa, and then it becomes posterior introcious nerve running at the back of the forearm. So when you open the cubital fossa, the four content that you can very comfortably and easily can appreciate, starting from medial to lateral side, is median nerve, you've got a brachial artery, tendon of biceps, biceps tendon, and superficial branch of radial nerve, the one which will be seen running and supplying the skin on the dorsum of the hand. The muscles which are forming the boundary of the cubital fossa, well, let's not use this picture to understand those muscles over there, although you can see brachioradialis and pronaterioteres, but let's use the other picture to understand the muscles which are forming the boundary of the cubital fossa and also other muscles in the anterior compartment of the forearm. Well guys, what we have with us next is, this is a picture of the anterior compartment of the forearm, and we'll be discussing it in actually two parts. Right now you're looking at the superficial muscles of the anterior compartment of forearm. Once you reflect the superficial muscles, you'll find one intermediate group also, if you call it an intermediate group, that is a flexor digitorum superficialis. And once you remove the flexor digitorum superficialis, you'll find the deeper muscles. Even before I help you to identify these muscles on this picture, let's see what are the muscles that we have in the anterior compartment of forearm. Now when I say anterior compartment of the forearm, so we have a superficial group first, and the superficial group muscles will be like pronated teres. There will be flexor carpi radialis. There is a muscle called as palmaris longus, not always present, but yeah, most of the time it is. So we got pronated teres, flexor carpi radialis, palmaris longus, flexor carpi ulnaris. So these are the like superficial muscles in the anterior compartment of the forearm. Let's stick to these four muscles first. Once again, if I just enlarge this a bit, if you look at this portion, you can see the cubital fossa here, right? Cubital fossa medial boundary is by this muscle, and that is the pronator teres muscle. We can better identify the pronator teres muscles once you remove this brachioradialis muscle from the side here. And remember one thing about the muscles in the anterior compartment of the forearm. See, medial epicondyle is a common flexor origin. Lateral epicondyle is a common extensor origin. So if you see a muscle coming from the medial epicondyle or from the medial side, even though it is going toward the lateral side in the forearm, but that tells you that this is the muscle of the anterior compartment of forearm, and the muscle that you see coming from the lateral epicondyle, even though if you see the muscle on the lateral side, more on the anterior aspect, but that doesn't make it the muscle of the anterior compartment of forearm, because it is coming from lateral epicondyle and that is a common extensor origin. This muscle that you see here, although it can be seen from the anterior aspect of the forearm, but this is the muscle which is supplied by the radial nerve, and it is considered as one of the extensor compartment muscle, originating from the lateral supracondylar ridge and forming the lateral boundary of the cubital fossa. This muscle is the brachioradialis. The muscle is brachioradialis. You can see it is forming the lateral boundary of this cubital fossa. That's the fossa here, right? We just discussed the content of the fossa. And this brachioradialis muscle, if I just try to trace this muscle, look carefully guys, the brachioradialis muscle tendon is coming here and it is going and ending here only at the lateral part of the styloid process. That's a tendon here coming and ending at the lateral part of the styloid process. Let me take you back here. So one muscle is pronator teres, this is brachioradialis, and they are forming the boundary of the cubital fossa. What other muscle we said is present superficially, in that sequence only, next to the pronator teres, if I just trace along with this muscle and go to the tendon here, This is the tendon of flexor carpi radialis. It's obviously going toward the radial side, so flexor carpi radialis. Whether it is flexor compartment and especially in the extensor compartment, it's not easy to differentiate the muscle in the upper part. You have to catch hold that tendon, and that will give you an idea about that what muscle is that. Because in the upper part, whether it is flexor or extensor compartment, look like that all the muscles are coming from the same region only. It's very difficult to differentiate the muscle belly of the FCR with the palmaris longus or with the other one, because they are all covered with a deep fascia, and sometimes these fascias are adherent. So that's a flexor carpi radialis muscle that you see present on the lateral side. Palmaris longus muscle is not shown here. See, how can I say that it is not shown? Flexor retinaculum is cut. Look at that. You can see all these tendons over there. That means there is no flexor retinaculum here. If there would have been a flexor retinaculum, then these tendons would have been deep to it. And palmaris longus is one muscle which is inserted on the superficial aspect of flexor retinaculum. So if I'm not able to see the flexor retinaculum, obviously I will not be able to see the palmaris longus, because they've removed the palmaris longus, they've cut the flexor retinaculum, and that is why you're able to see the tendons which are going into the carpal tunnel. So palmaris longus is not in here. The muscle that you can see on the ulnar side, this muscle on the ulnar side, look at this, is flexor carpi ulnaris. Again, the hint is that it's running on the medial side and going toward the ulnar region here, the flexor carpi ulnaris, which also forms a pisiform named sesamoid bone in its tendon. And because palmaris longus is not seen, I can see the flexor digitorum superficialis muscle here in between, which is sometimes regarded as an intermediate group. Like we have flexor carpi radialis, then we have palmaris longus, then we have flexor carpi ulnaris. You remove these three muscles, then we have flexor digitorum superficialis. So some author regarded as an intermediate group of muscle. Before we go to the deep group, something which we can appreciate close to the distal part of the forearm. Now, between the tendon of the flexor carpi radialis, lateral to flexor carpi radialis, remember that. But medial to this, what? That is brachioradialis. Can you see an artery running over there? Now guys, this artery here is the radial artery, which obviously will turn back here and then goes into the anatomical snuff box. So look at, between the FTS tendon and flexor carpi radialis, that is the radial artery to be appreciated here. That's a radial artery. And if you look at this flexor digitorum superficialis muscle, once you remove the palmaris longus and you remove flexor retinaculum, the two major nerves which enter into the hand can be appreciated on either side of the tendon of the FDS here. Look at, that's a tendon of flexor digitorum superficialis. Now this tuft of nerve, this is a tuft of nerve here guys, this here is actually the median nerve. And look at this nerve coming on to the, on the medial side, that is the ulnar nerve. So look at the tendon of flexor digitorum superficialis. If the palmaris longus from and the flexor retinaculum is removed from it, you can see the two nerves. The one which is more laterally placed, that's a median nerve. Obviously the nerve which is on the medial side, that is the ulnar nerve. Ulnar artery is not to be seen in this one. I'll show you in the next image here. So this is a picture showing the muscles of the anterior compartment of forearm, the superficial muscles of the anterior compartment of forearm. And I just repeat this one important point again. Look at, majority of the muscles are actually coming from the medial epicondyle, or at least from the medial side. They might come from the ulnar head, but that is still from the medial side. So that is a common flexor origin on this side here. The muscle coming from the lateral side, maybe from lateral epicondyle or from lateral supracondylar ridge, they are not the true muscles of the anterior compartment of forearm. They are the extensor group muscle. Although you can appreciate them from the anterior aspect, but still they are supplied by the radial nerve, like brachioradialis is supplied by the radial nerve. Next up, here we have a picture in which the flexor carpi radialis muscle is removed so that we can clearly see the flexor digitorum superficialis tendon. So that's again the same kind of picture only, but there are a few more things we can appreciate in this. Okay. Although these are the cut section, but I still want to take your attention to the lateral side. Okay, look at these at least three muscles which I can appreciate here. This one and this one here. This is actually brachioradialis muscle coming from lateral supracondylar ridge. Another muscle from the lateral supracondylar ridge here, this is the extensor carpi radialis longus. And deeper to that is extensor carpi radialis brevis. ECRL and ECRB, the muscle which are present all on the lateral side here. These muscles can be appreciated from the back of the forearm. We'll see that. I'm just telling you that you can see all the three muscles are coming from the lateral side. They are the extensor group of muscle here. So when you see them, if you look at the cut section here, the most superficial muscle and having the highest origin also is the brachioradialis, followed by the ECRL, extensor carpi radialis longus, and deeper to that, which is coming from actually lateral epicondyle itself, is the extensor carpi radialis brevis. Although that is not our discussion portion right now, we are looking at the muscles of the anterior compartment of forearm here. Once again, this is a picture which clearly shows you the entire pronator teres muscle. Now that's a pronator teres muscle which is inserted onto the lateral side of the middle of the shaft of the radius here. That's the muscle which you see ending in the middle of the forearm only. So this is the pronator teres. And look at this muscle here, which can now be more clearly seen, is a flexor digitorum superficialis. That's a flexor digitorum superficialis. You know, it's easy to identify the flexor digitorum superficialis and profundus muscle by looking at the tendon in the distal part of the wrist and in the hand. But like right now, we're looking at the forearm here. So when I'll show you the next flexor digitorum profundus muscle, you can have a like visual comparison between the two muscles, that how will you identify which one is FDS and which one is FDP. The muscle which is present deep to it, can you see a muscle deep to it? No, it's not the muscle only on the ulnar side, because it's a deeper muscle present in the entire aspect here. That is actually flexor digitorum profundus muscle. Guys, flexor carpi ulnaris is cut here. Look at that cut section. Can you see that cut section here? That's a flexor carpi ulnaris muscle which is being cut. Which muscle was overlapping it here? Once that flexor carpi ulnaris was there, you were not able to see the FDP. Once you remove that muscle, just onto the side of FDS, I can see some part of FDP can be seen. Flexor digitorum profundus can be seen there. Okay. What else? If I just enlarge this picture a bit more here. Now, can you see another muscle and the tendon going toward the lateral side? Now, this muscle which is originating from the anterior surface of the radius. So, obviously, it is on toward the lateral side. Any muscle on this lateral side is obviously subjected to go toward the thumb only. So, it's a long flexor of the thumb. This muscle, another deep muscle, is a flexor pollicis longus. We'll show you both these muscles in the next section also. But just to tell you, out of the three deep muscles in the anterior compartment of the forearm, two can be appreciated even when FDS is intact. So flexor digitorum superficialis is still intact. On the medial side of it, I can see the FDP. And on the lateral side of it, I can see this flexor pollicis longus muscle. Look at this long tendon going into the thumb, which we can appreciate better in the next image. Okay, the third and the final picture that we have for the anterior compartment of forearm is showing the deepest muscle in the anterior compartment. So we're done with the superficial group of muscle. The intermediate group is all about FDS. And the deep muscles, there are three deep muscles we have. If I name it for you first, one is flexor digitorum profundus, as we already said, flexor pollicis longus, and pronator quadratus. And I would say pronator quadratus out of these three is still the deepest, because when these two muscles are intact, it's a bit difficult to appreciate the pronator quadratus muscle. Look at this big muscle here, guys, again having these tendons going into the digits here, and this one and this one, they are all tendons of FDP, flexor digitorum profundus. I'll help you trace this muscle distally as well. And this muscle, if I again go with the tendon here, that's the one which is going into the thumb. You can clearly see now the tendon is going into the thumb here. This is flexor pollicis longus. The flexor pollicis longus. Let's have a closer look at the tendons when you see it in the distal part here. There we go. Now, can you see the flexor digitorum profundus tendon? Because you can see the cut section of flexor digitorum superficialis tendon here. This is always a helpful thing, you know, when you especially looking at the these tendons in the hand. If you see all the tendons intact, that obviously looking at a FDS tendon, because to see the FDP, flexor digitorum profundus tendon, we have to remove FDS. So they will always show the cut section of the FDS tendon, and then only FDP can be seen here. So that's a flexor digitorum profundus tendon here. The FDS tendon are these which are shown cut, that is FDS tendons. And clearly look at this one, that's the flexor pollicis longus, the only muscle in the anterior compartment of forearm which is going deep to the flexor retinaculum and ultimately reaching to the distal phalanx of the thumb. It's a long, long flexor of the thumb, flexor pollicis longus. pronator quadratus muscle, to see the pronator quadratus muscle, I have to consider another picture in which we again remove these two muscles also. Then we go even deeper. So there is a quadrangular muscle which is present on the ventral aspect of the radius and ulna in the lower part. And that's a very, very easy muscle to identify. That is called as pronator quadratus. Here we go. Look at this muscle here. So now if everything is removed here, this muscle is the pronator quadratus muscle. And you can see the interosseous membrane, and running in front of the interosseous membrane, that is an anterior interosseous nerve and anterior interosseous artery and vein, the vessels will be there. So you can see the anterior interosseous nerve and anterior interosseous artery can be seen running in front of interosseous membrane, passing deep to the pronator quadratus here, of course. So that is about identifying the muscles in the anterior compartment of forearm and the content of cubital fossa. The another challenge comes is then we have to identify the nerves and vessels at the region of the flexor retinaculum or at the wrist, and then in the hand also. So again, you know, if you have to identify that first, the section is at what level? Is it a superficial dissection or is it a deep dissection? Now look at this picture here. This is a picture which is kind of reflecting one of a very recent question asked in the AIIMS exam. Now you have a lot of nerves and tendons and vessels present at the wrist joint and then entering into the hand here. Now to identify that whether it is a nerve or artery, I know that we have some standard protocols for that nerve is more glistening, arteries are tubular structures. But you know, if it is it's an old specimen, then these things may not work. The nerve may not look like a nerve exactly. It may be a bit dark in color. Artery may not look as tubular as it should look in a standard the cadaveric section. So we got to go with the relations. Something which will never betray you is the relations of the structures. Okay. Now this is a dissection of the anterior aspect of the hand or the palm region, and it's a very superficial dissection, you see, because only the skin is removed here. Once you remove the skin from the flexor retinaculum, look at this extension here, is called as palmar aponeurosis. That's a palmar aponeurosis. As I said, I'll be giving you all these raw images and the labeled images, well-planned labeled images in the soft copy. So just right now, just keep looking at the video here. So it's a palmar aponeurosis, the triangular aponeurosis we have. In the foot, we have a plantar aponeurosis. And this palmar aponeurosis is coming from this flexor retinaculum. And if you go along with this palmar aponeurosis, more proximally, this is actually the continuation of tendon of palmaris longus. So it's a palmaris longus tendon that you see here, and this is the one which is spanning into the. And what is the need of this palmar aponeurosis or plantar aponeurosis? They are the protective structures, you know, especially in the foot, when you know all the lateral plantar, medial plantar nerve in the foot, they're protected by this aponeurosis in the foot here, also help in the maintaining the arches. Same in the hand. So many nerves and blood vessels are there in the hand, and so we need a protective layer covering them, and that's where the aponeurosis come into the picture. Okay, what else, guys? A superficial muscle can be seen. I'm going with the muscles first. A superficial muscle can be seen here. The one muscle which is having attachment to the palmar aponeurosis, and it's a muscle present underneath the skin on the ulnar side, and it is very frequently absent also. This muscle is called as the palmaris brevis muscle, one of the hypothenar muscle which may be absent, having no bony attachment. Look at this more or less horizontally placed muscle here is a palmaris brevis muscle here. It's a very superficial muscle. You can see all the nerves and vessels are passing deep to it only, nothing is superficial. Thenar and hypothenar. When you look at the thenar muscles, to identify the thenar muscles, see, thenar muscles are, we have flexor pollicis brevis. There is a muscle there called as abductor pollicis brevis. Then there is a muscle opponens pollicis, and there is a muscle adductor pollicis. Flexor pollicis brevis, abductor pollicis brevis, opponens pollicis, and adductor pollicis, the four thenar muscles that we have. If you are looking at a superficial dissection of the hand, do not expect to see the opponens muscle. Opponents muscle are for the opposition of thumb and the opposition of little finger, opponents digita minimi or opponents pollicis. And because these muscles need to insert to the metacarpal. So they're very deeply placed muscle. In the superficial dissection, if you're able to see the palmar epineurosis, if you're able to see the other thinar muscles, so do not expect to see the opponent's pollicis muscle here. Then one muscle which is a thinar muscle but not forming a thinar eminence is an adductor pollicis. So that muscle is also not present in this eminent area here. Opponent's pollicis cannot be seen and adductor pollicis not in this eminent region here. So that means we have two muscles to be identified here. The muscle that you see present more laterally here, this one, and there's a muscle present this one here. Now it's a very obvious thing, guys. If a muscle is present more on the outer aspect, the muscle can do abduction. Same attachment muscle, if it is present on more on the palmar aspect, that can do flexion here. So when you see two muscles side by side, even if you're not able to distinguish between the fibers of the two muscles, the muscle which is placed more laterally here is the abductor pollicis brevis muscle, and the one which is more medially placed is the flexor pollicis brevis muscle. And the same principle is applicable on the ulnar side as well. When you see on the medial side, you can apply the same principle. Look at the two muscles which I can see here, the muscle which is present on more on the outer aspect here, this is the abductor digiti minimi, and the muscle that you see more inside here, this is flexor digiti minimi. Again, I cannot see opponent's pollicis because you got to kind of separate these two muscles, flexor pollicis brevis and abductor pollicis brevis, and you'll find the opponent's pollicis in between. So when you're looking at a superficial dissection of the palmar aspect, do not expect to see opponent's pollicis. Thinar eminence is not made up of the adductor pollicis, the two muscles only. The one on the lateral side has to be abductor, they can abduct, so they are more on the outer aspect. And the muscle which is more medially placed, more toward the inner aspect, that is flexor digiti minimi, and that's a flexor pollicis brevis. That's about the muscle. About the nerve and vessel, now if you look at, there is an artery which you can see here, a nerve that you can see here, just deep to the palmaris longus, deep and slightly lateral, this nerve is the median nerve. The nerve passing through the carpal tunnel, that is a median nerve. You can see it is entering into this carpal tunnel only. That is a median nerve here, which can be very, very easily confused with all these tendons, the tendons of flexor carpi, radialis and all look like a nerve only. So again, maybe the color, the texture may not help you. Just go with the relation, guys. Palmaris longus tendon, just deep and lateral to it, you will see the median nerve present over there. On this side, on the ulnar side, again, you can see some structures present here. Like this, if I go with a relation here, the one which is more inside, if you can appreciate in this picture, the one which is more inside is the ulnar artery, the standard relation, and the one which is more outside, or you can say more medially placed, that is the ulnar nerve. If the flexor retinaculum is cut and they are showing any cadaveric image, these relations might be a bit distorted here. They might show through the nerve and artery kind of overlapping each other. So this might not be the standard way to look at the nerve and the artery. But if the flexor retinaculum is intact, like in this picture, and all the tendons are arranged in a particular sequence, and the nerves are vessels can be seen, then you'll find the nerve is present more toward the medial side, artery is more toward the lateral side here. Although it can be understood by looking at these nerves and vessels into the palmar aspect. And for that, we have to remove palmar aponeurosis. Once I remove the palmar aponeurosis, it will become more clear that which one is a nerve and which one is an artery. But as I said, as a standard relations, when the retinaculum is intact, the one on the medial side is a nerve, one on the lateral side is the artery, ulnar nerve and ulnar artery. That is the one big confusion which most of the people had in this recent conducted AIMS exam. But as per the feedback, I know that in that exam, the palmar aponeurosis was not intact. So they could trace the nerve and artery more distally into the hand, and based on that, we can identify that whether it is the artery or the nerve. So even before I show you the nerve and vessels into the distal part of the in the distal region here onto the hand, first look at some tendons here, because once you remove palmar aponeurosis, apart from the nerves and vessels, you will see the FDS tendon and FDB tendon passing there, and some intrinsic muscles of hand are also related to them. Okay. So guys, here is a picture. in which, again, the flexor retinaculum is cut. Look at this, that's a flexor retinaculum is removed. And you can see these lot of tendons which are coming and going into the fingers here. Before I go to those tendons, one muscle which we missed in the previous part, we said this is a abductor is here, flexor will be on this side here, then this is again abductor, this is flexor here. One thinar muscle that we said, which is not a muscle of thinar eminence, is this muscle here. This is an adductor pollicis muscle. The muscle here is the adductor pollicis muscle, more of a the horizontally placed muscle going toward the thumb, that is adductor pollicis. We can see this adductor pollicis even in the next section when we actually tendons are also removed here. Now we have a tendon of FDS and FDP. How will you identify them? That's pretty simple. I mean, you don't have to bother about whether it looks superficial or deep. Obviously, if the tendon looks intact, it is not cut here. From the superficial aspect, you will see the FDS tendon. If they will be showing you the picture of FDP tendon, they have to reflect this tendon and cut it also. So you will definitely see a cut section of the tendon, and then the tendon present deep to it will be the FDP. So these tendons here, the one that you're looking at, these are all FDS tendon. This one, this one, this here. So these are all flexor digitorum superficialis tendon, guys. These are all FDS tendons. So this will help you in identifying the nerves and vessels also. So I'm moving toward that part here. That's FDS. And once again, trace this tendon and look at this. That is going toward the thumb only. The same flexor pollicis longus. FPL. Flexor pollicis longus. This whole thing is a flexor pollicis longus tendon only. Just for your... That is flexor carpi radialis. Obviously attached to the carpal bone only. So it's not going... to the any of the metacarpal or to the phalanges, that is a flexor carpi radialis. Once I remove this FDS tendon, once I remove the FDS tendon, then you will see the FDP tendon and flexor digitorum profundus tendon are known for giving origin to the lumbrical muscles. Although I can see the lumbrical muscle here also, so it can confuse with you that whether lumbricals are coming from FDS or FDP, they are coming from FDP, which can be more clearly seen in the next image, and here we have it. Look at this picture here. Now guys, clearly now you can say this is definitely the picture of the FDP tendon. Can you see the cut section of FDS? Now this flexor digitorum superficialis tendon, this flexor digitorum superficial tendons are cut and you can see the FDP tendons now. And coming from this FDP tendon are the four lumbricals. If I give them, this is L1, the first lumbrical. This is L2, the second lumbrical. What do you see the property of the lumbricals? You can see the first and second lumbricals are unipinnate. They're only arising from the lateral side of tendon of index finger and the tendon of middle finger. So they are the unipinnate type of muscle. Whereas look at this. Look at this lumbrical here and this one also. So these are the two lumbricals which are bipinnate. L3 and L4. The two bipinnate lumbrical which are originating from the contiguous side of the tendon of the middle and ring finger, ring and little finger. So the four lumbricals, first and second lumbrical, if you know, they are supplied by the median nerve, and third and fourth lumbrical, they are supplied by the ulnar nerve. Just an additional information here. The bipinnate lumbricals are by ulnar nerve and unipinnate are by the median nerve. So this is basically the picture to show the deeper tendon here. So when you see the FDS tendons, FDP tendons will be deeper to it. If they are showing you the FDP tendon, they have to cut the FDS or reflect them to one side or something. So you can easily find out, okay, the one tendon is reflected or cut. So the deeper one is a FDP, flexor digitorum profundus. Once I remove all these tendons and the lumbricals also, then the deepest muscle that you'll see, I have to come to the nerves and vessels, but I said I need to tell you about the muscle first. If I remove all these tendons and I go even deeper to this, then you'll find the interossei. The palmar interossei and the dorsal interossei. Now look at this picture here. That's a picture showing the palmar interossei. Guys, palmar interossei could be 3 to 4 in number. Why I'm saying 3 to 4 in number? Because the thumb, the first palmar interossei can be absent. Thumb is already having a very, very strong adductor called as adductor pollicis. So there's no need for the interossei for the thumb. So it like may or may not be seen. Rest of the fingers, they need to have palmar interossei. Like this one is having a palmar interossei, that is the first palmar interossei. If I just mark 1, 2, and 3. Now, few things to be noticed here. All the palmar interossei are unipinnate. First of all the palmar introchae are unipinnate. They're arising only from one side. Second important thing, the first palmar introchae will help in the adduction of the index finger toward the middle. And the second and the third, the one which we have here, the two introchae here will help in the adduction of the ring finger and the little finger toward the middle. That means it's the middle finger which is devoid of palmar introchae. That also is one of the question asked. Palmar introchae is absent on middle finger. There is no need. When you do the adduction abduction, the one finger which is not moving is what? It's a middle finger only. So coming close is adduction, and that's why there is no need for the palmar introchae on the middle finger. So tendon on the dorsal aspect of the middle finger, another recent AIMS question, tendon on the dorsal aspect of the middle finger is having insertion of the lumbricals also, interossei also, but it is not having an insertion of the palmar introchae because palmar introchae is absent on middle finger. On the other hand, when you look at the dorsal introchae, if I show you this picture of the dorsal introchae here, look at that. That's a picture from the dorsal aspect only. That's the better way to look at it. Dorsal introchae, now this time there's a thumb here, so we are starting from here. That's the first one, the second, third, and the fourth. So dorsal introchae are four in number, and all dorsal introchae are bipinnate in nature. You can see they are all originating from both the side of the metacarpals, from the shaft of metacarpal, the first one, second, third, and fourth, all of them. As we know, dorsal introchae, the function is what? Abduction. Now, when you say dorsal introchae is for abduction, guys, we don't need an abductor for the thumb. We have already two abductors for the thumb. No need. We don't need an abductor for little finger. We have a muscle called as abductor digitae minimi. Again, not required. That means the four dorsal introchae are to be adjusted on three fingers here. You can see the first one is going to where? It is going to the ring finger. The fourth one is going to the ring finger. That is going to the index finger, first one to the index finger, the fourth one to the ring finger, and the remaining two are going to the middle finger only. That means the tendon of the middle finger, which was not having a palmar introchae, but will have two dorsal introchae inserting to it. There are two dorsal introchae inserted onto the tendon of extensor tendon of the middle finger here. This time, that means the last digit, that is the little finger and the thumb, they are devoid of dorsal introchae. It's recently there are a lot of questions on these introchae and the lumbricals. So you know that, you should know this here, that palmar introchae was absent on middle finger. Dorsal introchae are absent on what? Thumb and the little finger. And in the palmar introchae, let's say they ask you that apart from the middle finger, which other finger may not have a palmar introchae is a thumb. Because we already said thumb don't need a palmar introchae. Thumb is already having its adductor. There is no need for an adductor muscle for the thumb specially here. And all the dorsal and the palmar introchae, they are all supplied by what nerve? They are all supplied by the ulnar nerve. They're all of them are supplied by the ulnar nerve. Well, this is about the muscles of the anterior compartment of the forearm, the superficial, the deep muscle, intermediate group. We talked about how the structures are running at the wrist and then the muscles in the hand here. Now, coming to that main point here, guys, when the nerves and vessels, they cross the wrist joint and reach the hand, it at times it becomes difficult to identify the ulnar nerve, ulnar artery, and the same with the median nerve and radial artery here. So let's look at a picture in which we'll try to identify those things. Well, that's a kind of picture which was given in the exam, and here we have to identify it. See, once again, you can see the thinar muscles are intact. You can see all the long tendons are going into the finger. So this is not a deep dissection. We just have removed the palmar introchae only, and the flexor retinaculum is maybe cut. It's not cut in this picture. Partly it is cut only. So that means it is a very superficial dissection only. And when you have a superficial dissection, just keep it in mind that you cannot see the deep branch of ulnar nerve. We call it a deep branch of ulnar nerve. It is situated very deep. Deep to even tendons of FDS and FDP. Imagine. All the tendons of FDF, FDP, deep to them we have the ulnar nerve. So if you see something making an arch from the ulnar side, it cannot be ulnar nerve. It has to be the ulnar artery only. So this here is the ulnar artery. Look at this. That's the ulnar artery to be seen. And what you see, if I trace this ulnar artery, guys, look at this. This ulnar artery goes like this and then make it an arch on this side. This arch, as I hope you all know, is called as a superficial palmar arch. made up of ulnar artery. That arch is called as a superficial palmar arch. It is superficial to all these tendons of FDS, FDP, lumbricals. It's a very superficially placed structures, just deep to the palmar aponeurosis only. Giving off all these common digital artery and then proper digital artery. Let's not go into that. Whereas on this side, apart from this, the glistening tendon here, that's a tendon of the FCR, flexor carpi radialis again, that's a FCR tendon. The nerve that you see here, that is a median nerve. Look at this. That is a nerve here. This is a median nerve. Again, you can see the FDS tendon. I told you, just lateral to FDS, median nerve, just medial to FDS, there is the ulnar nerve. You can see the ulnar nerve also coming out from there. That's a median nerve, and here is the ulnar nerve to be seen. If you're not able to see this very well in your phones or something, you can always look into the PDF that I'll send you. You can always enlarge it and can clearly see that where the nerve and artery is. So again, FDS, guys, this is FDS, flexor digitorum superficialis. I told you earlier, lateral to it, nerve, medial to it, the ulnar nerve, median nerve, when it goes deep to all these flexor retinaculum, it gives off this branch here. Look at this branch. It comes back and supply the thinar muscle, and we call it the recurrent branch of the median nerve. That's a recurrent branch of the median nerve, which comes back and supply the thinar muscles here. The recurrent branch of the median nerve. And one more structure which is worth identifying it here. If you see more laterally here, the structure which is not crossing the retinaculum or anything like that, this is the one which goes into the snuff box. That is the radial artery to be seen. That's a radial artery to be seen here. If palmaris longus tendon would have been here, it would be like overlapping this FDS. And I told you, deep to the palmaris longus tendon and just lateral to it, you'll find the median nerve. Then we have FCR tendon, flexor carpi radialis, and more laterally is the artery here. You can see the radial artery, and the radial artery obviously which will turn and then goes into the anatomical snuff box, which we will see in the upcoming section. So that's the ulnar artery and the ulnar nerve. So just to take you back to the question which was asked. So guys, if the section is superficial, which is not difficult at all to identify whether it's a superficial or deep section. If the section is superficial, if there's a superficial dissection, only palmar aponeurosis is removed. Then obviously you cannot see the arch of the ulnar nerve. Ulnar nerve also make an arch. So that can confuse the ulnar artery and the ulnar nerve. But the thing is, the superficial palmar arch, which is an arterial arch made up of ulnar artery, not of the nerve. The nerve goes quite deep and then it forms an arch which is deep to even the tendons of FDP. So it's a very, very deeply placed arch, which I'm going to show you in the next section. So look at the very next section, guys, in which we removed all the thinar muscles. Let's remove hypothinar muscles also here. Let's remove all these superficial palmar arch, FDS tendon, FDP tendon. The interossei will be seen. There we go. Look at that. Right? All the thinar muscles are being removed. Hypothinar are being cut and reflected here. No tendons can be seen here. No palmar arches, no palmar aponeurosis. The carpal tunnel is empty. Nothing can be seen in there. Now look at these two arches that here. One arch is coming from this side, one arch is coming from that side. The arch coming from medial side, guys, this here is the ulnar nerve, and this is a deep branch of ulnar nerve which makes an arch like this. That's a deep branch of ulnar nerve which is making an arch. It ends by supplying the adductor pollicis muscle. It supplies all interossei. You can see the nerve is coming and supplying all these muscles, and it ends by supplying adductor pollicis muscle. Whereas from the first web space, when you see from the lateral side, from the first web space, an artery is coming out here, and that is the deep palmar arch, which is formed by what artery? By the radial artery. You know, radial artery goes into the snuff box, and then it goes between the first dorsal interossei, comes onto the palmar aspect, but very, very deeply placed. That's why the arch is also called as a deep palmar arch. So you can see a nerve, and underneath the nerve, you can see the arterial arch present here. So that means there are three structures in the hand which are forming the arches. And once again, I'm just summarizing it for you. If you see an arch present very superficially and starting from the medial side, if you're not able to distinguish between the artery and nerve, it has to be an arterial arch. Guys, it is a superficial palmar arch formed by the ulnar artery. Deep dissection, remove the tendons of the hand, only interossei can be seen. Then you see an arch coming from the medial side. It is an arch of the deep branch of ulnar nerve. At the same level, if you see the arch coming from the lateral side and arching toward the medial nerve, and that is an arterial arch called as a deep palmar arch made up of the radial artery. So that's how you identify the sections. You first have to look at whether the section is a deep or is it a superficial dissection, then only you can identify whether it's an artery or the nerve. And next step, guys, let's come to the posterior compartment of the forearm. Now again, posterior compartment of forearm is having muscle which are some superficially placed muscle and deep muscle. We have a lot of muscles in the posterior compartment of forearm. But you know, if you go again with from the relation point of view, it's not difficult to identify these muscles at all, because majority of the muscles which are present superficially, they are oriented toward the fingers only. So you'll see them running like this straight into the digits or four digits or maybe into the thumb also. But the deeply placed muscle, they are running more obliquely like this and then going toward the thumb and forming the boundaries of the anatomical snuff box. So their orientation will always help you identify the muscles in there. Now that's a picture of the back of the forearm, in which it's not easy at all to identify these muscles in the superficial, in the upper part here. Because again, the deep fascia is intact on all the muscle. It's very, very difficult to distinguish between the origin of the extensor carpi ulnaris from the digitorum and all. So you have to look into the tendon part in the distal region. So I'm pretty sure that if they give a question on the back of the forearm, they will give you the tendon also in the distal part where they are going. Otherwise, it's virtually impossible to identify the muscle in the upper part, in the very much proximal region. Okay, as I said, if we look at, there are three muscles, the three main muscles present in there. If I just try to kind of highlight these muscles for you, this here is one tendon that you see present on the ulnar side. This one main tendon that you see right now present on the radial side, and this big muscle in between here, this one, I'm not highlighting its tendon here. Look at this muscle, guys. This muscle here is the extensor digitorum muscle. That muscle here is an extensor digitorum muscle. You can see all the tendons of this going into the dorsum of the fingers and forming a dorsal digital expansion. On the medial side, obviously this tendon, if you trace the tendon here again, the tendon is going into the little finger here. So that's not into the little finger, sorry. It is ending at the carpal bone. That's the extensor carpi ulnaris. And again, the muscle which is kind of difficult to distinguish, along with the extensor digitorum, can you see an additional tendon here, an extra tendon here going to the little finger? This is the tendon of extensor digiti minimi. As I said, you have to trace this tendon distally to the finger to identify what exactly is that. Imagine if I just hide this lower part and you look at the muscles in that, it's not easy to identify which one is digitorum, where the ulnaris is starting. You got to look at the tendons here. Extensor carpi ulnaris tendon ends here only at the carpals. Extensor digitorum going into the fingers. Look at this one, this one, this one, and this one also. They're all extensor digitorum tendon. Little finger is having an extra tendon here, that is extensor digiti minimi tendon. And look at this tendon going to the thumb here. This tendon, which can be better appreciated in the other different view, but just to tell you guys, this is a tendon of extensor pollicis longus. It's a tendon of the extensor pollicis longus, which also can be seen if you're looking at the forearm in this manner. But to tell you the deeper muscle, to identify the deeper muscle, there is one more muscle present superficially only, but to see that, I have to kind of remove the extensor digitorum. Deep to extensor digitorum, there is another muscle that's an additional muscle or tendon for the index finger, that is called as extensor indicus. So deep to it, there's another tendon that you'll see going into the index finger, and that can be appreciated in this picture. Look at that, guys. Look at this picture here. Another, when the extensor digitorum was present on that, you could not see all these muscles. You remove the digitorum and everything, then you can see this muscle here, the tendon going into the index finger, that is the extensor indicus, an additional tendon to the index finger, that is extensor indicus. I can very clearly see the snuff box also here. If you could appreciate that snuff box region here, you can see the two tendons are in the floor of the snuff box, and then we have some forming the boundary. Well, this may not be the ideal picture to show the snuff box, because to show the snuff box, it's better if I show you the image something like this. So if I turn this hand laterally, So I can see very clearly the tendons which are forming the boundary as well as the floor of the anatomical snowball. So to see these tendons here, let me consider another picture here. And that's a one last picture we are discussing here in the upper limb. That's a picture looking at like in this manner, guys. You can see the thumb. The trace this tendon, like this is a tendon here again, that is an extensor pollicis longus tendon. Let me mark it for you. That's a tendon of extensor pollicis longus tendon, which is one of the boundary of the snuff box. Whereas the two structures forming the lateral boundary here, one is the abductor pollicis longus, which is more outside placed. And can you see a very, very thin tendon here? A very thin tendon going to the thumb only, that is a extensor pollicis brevis. The two tendons which are forming the lateral boundary of the snuff box is abductor pollicis longus, extensor pollicis brevis. One which is forming the lateral boundary is extensor pollicis longus, forming the medial boundary, extensor pollicis longus. And one thing I want to note here, look at the two tendons which are present forming the floor. Apart from the bones, we have the two tendons forming the floor of the anatomical snuff box, and that is extensor carpi radialis longus and extensor carpi radialis brevis, ECRL and ECRB. The one which is laterally placed is ECRL, the one which is medially placed is ECRB. That's not important here, but the two tendons forming the floor is ECRL and ECRB. And the one content, look at that, the main content of the anatomical snuff box is this radial artery running in. The radial artery which turns backward deep to these tendons into the anatomical snuff box, and we already know the future course, the nerve artery will go between the first web space and forms a deep palmar arch, which we just saw in the deep dissection of the palmar aspect. So guys, this is about the muscles and the tendons of the upper limb and how to identify the blood vessels and nerve in it. The only challenge is when you have to identify the nerves of the brachial plexus. So I would say that make sure that you look at that part of the video very well, the brachial plexus branches, and also identifying the nerves and vessels when they cross the wrist joint and reach the hand. Which one is superficial palmar arch? What is it made up of? Where will you find it? And same with the deep one here. So that's all about this part. In the next video, we'll be talking about the lower limb muscles and the blood vessels and the nerves of the lower limb as well, and how to identify them again on the cadaveric sections here. Thank you so much for now. Have a good day.